Harper Audio present A Very Inconvenient Scandal, a novel by Jacquelyn Mitchard, performed by Carolyn Hewitt. For Deb T. and Diana B., and for Jeff Kleinman. The cure for anything is salt water, sweat, tears, or the sea. Isak Dinesen. He prayeth well who loveth well all things, both great and small. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. 1. Something terrible had happened, but Frankie didn't know what it was. In her rental car, she pulled up in front of her childhood home. Not a single light. Not a single sound. Was Mac already dead? Was he in the hospital? "Please come home," read the text on her phone. "Urgent. Today. Here is your ticket number." Her father had made her reservation and paid for her ticket. Everything about it was strange. Mac was not the type to say please, nor to splurge on pricey airline fares. And if you were on your deathbed, you didn't send your own message. So, the something terrible must have happened to her brother, Penn, or her beloved best friend since fourth grade, Ariel, as close as any sibling. All the texts she sent as she rushed through 3,000 miles between airports went unanswered. On the drive from Boston to Cape Cod, she hit redial on everyone's number until her phone was out of charge. No one picked up. She could not bear it. The last time she'd been here, just over a year ago, was for the funeral of her mother, Beatrice, her rock, her mainstay, struck down overnight from strep at the age of 52. "Oh, please no more," Frankie thought, remembering a line from an old poem her mother used to read to her and Penn. So far, so early, so soon. Exhausted, sweaty, pregnant, thirsty, nauseated, her distended bladder a taut water balloon, she lumbered out of the car and stumbled to the place on the front steps where she knew a key was wedged under the bottom of a big stone planter. But wait, where... The planter was gone. Frankie went back to the car and flipped on the headlights, then the brights. Two huge new bright metal planters flanked the entryway, overflowing with the gaudy bells and tongue-like flowers of fuchsia plants. She fumbled in one, then the other, until she located a slim metal magnetized key holder. Didn't burglars know about these things too? The facade of the White House with its three wings and extravagant second-floor porches reared up before her, summiting a slight rise from the curl and boom of the surf. For the first time since Frankie could remember, the whole place was freshly painted. A door of marine blue, and shiny black shutters jaunty as bright lapels on a tuxedo. Still, though the paint might be new, Frankie knew every cleft and corner of this old house— every change cobbled skillfully onto the main building by six generations of her mother's family. Despite her old grief and new worry, she nearly wept with relief. Much as she loved her work, which took her all over the world, there still were many nights when she dreamed that she was 8 years old, running from the pond with her brother under the long avenue of smoke trees in all their pink summer finery, to this house, which would always be home. "Dad?" she called as she noisily unlocked the door and stepped into the foyer, reaching for the light switch, flinching at the glare from a new overhead fixture like a gigantic suspended gyroscope. Bright white wainscoting, translucent blue floor tiles. What? More redecorating? From Mac, who had sweatshirts older than his children? He really did have a screw loose. Everything was different. Walls, floors, furniture, windows. The only things she still recognized were a gigantic print of one of her own best-known underwater photos, the placid, bemused gaze of a manatee, and Beatrice's big painting that looked like the undulating hills of a desert, but was actually a close-up detail of an angular Triton shell. Such giant close-ups were their art in common. "Dad!" Frankie shouted, louder. "Dad, are you here?" No sound, except the tinny exhalation of the air conditioning. Frankie made her way down the wide, dark hall to the closed door of the master bedroom. "Dad? Dad?" A cough, or a groan, issued from within. That was Mac. He really was sick. She'd arrived just in time. Pushing her way in, Frankie flipped on all the lights. Bare-chested, tanned, and fit, Mac sat up. Next to him, pushing her white blonde hair out of her eyes, was Ariel. Ariel? The world slipped. A piano fell out of the sky and clanged to the ground, narrowly missing her head. Frankie screamed. She screamed again. Ariel rolled out of bed and stood up. Under her huge white t-shirt protruded her hugely pregnant belly. Frankie ran to the hall bathroom, where she managed to get to the sink in time to throw up.
"Frankie, let me in."
It was Ariel's voice.
"Let me explain."
Frankie couldn't answer. She clung to the sink and sluiced her face with cold water. Ariel called,
"Frankie, answer me."
"Get my brother,"
Frankie said through the locked door.
"Get Pen, I'm sick."
"She's sick,"
Ariel said to someone.
"I told you that we should—"
Mac rattled the knob.
"Frankie, come out right now."
Frankie leaned against the door, trying to knit common sense with what she'd just seen. Ariel was, after all, the administrator and its only permanent employee of the Saltwater Foundation, the nonprofit organization for the conservation of marine animals, Mac's life work. Had Mac forced Ariel? Frankie hunched over the sink in a fresh churn of nausea. Or had Ariel somehow... was Mac suffering from some kind of dementia? At last, it was her brother's voice.
"Frankie, are you okay?"
"Help me," she said. "What the hell? What's happening?"
She opened the door and poked her head out. With his curly, dark hair stuck up like springs and his skinny legs poking out of his boxers, Penn stood there in his ancient gray t-shirt that read, "Sorry, I can't. It's Shark Week." In her bare feet, just behind Penn, Ariel seemed even tinier than her 5'2". Her long, nearly white blonde hair pulled up in a toppling bun, purplish smudges of exhaustion under her eyes. A few minutes later in the kitchen, Penn sat beside Frankie, ineffectually holding one of her wrists, while Ariel rushed around making her a cup of tea, giving her dry toast for the nausea, as if this were the set of some British TV show instead of her mother's kitchen on Cape Cod. Her mother's very kitchen, from which everything Beatrice treasured had been removed.
"It's a lot, Frankie,"
Ariel said softly.
"I should have told you."
"You think?"
Frankie replied.
"I'm having a baby. I'm getting married."
Ariel stopped. She blinked, then she said,
How did you guess?"
"What?" Frankie was confused.
"How did I guess what?"
"That I was pregnant."
"You mean before or now?"
"Geez, Ariel. I majored in biology. I have eyes. But actually, I was referring to myself, you cow. Me. I am pregnant.
Almost 5 months.
Even before I got the big emergency text from Mac, I was already coming home soon to tell you my big surprise."
"I never thought you had an even bigger surprise, that you were screwing my dad." She cupped her hand and drank cold water from the faucet.
"Is it his? Or, sorry, do you even know?"
"Don't you dare talk to me like that, Frankie.
In your own house? Right, all yours. Not everybody who sleeps with the boss gets a 9-bedroom beachfront house, and hey, that's my mom's 25th anniversary ring on your hand. Not bad, Ariel. Trashy girls everywhere are going to get tattoos of you.
Listen to yourself, Frankie. You should be ashamed of yourself. I already said I was sorry.
You should be sorry, Frankie said stoutly, but she thought, she's right. I really should be ashamed of myself.
I'm not sorry for this. I'm sorry for not telling you. That was really dumb and wrong.
Now wearing a pink and navy checked shirt, his hair neatly brushed, Mac burst into the room.
Girls, stop, stop. I'm honestly sorry you found us that way, honey. But of course Ariel and I are getting married.
Dad, have you lost your mind? Frankie shouted. You're,
with a 27-year-old? A girl? Your own daughter's age? I don't think of it that way. Ariel is very,
Mac began.
Yes, apparently.
Cut it out, Frankie. You're being a bitch because you think you can get away with it, Ariel said.
But you can't. I'm not going to listen to this.
Ariel is very dear to me, Mac went on. We're going to have a baby.
Clearly, for Mac at least, this explained matters. Frankie's geriatric father had gotten a girl in trouble. He had to do the right thing by her. Mac turned to Ariel, reaching over to smooth her long summer t-shirt against her bulging belly in a gesture of such proprietary intimacy that Frankie, who thought she was finished throwing up, felt her stomach squirm again. She had to pass between them. Their skin smells of soap and salt and something loamy intercut with a bright pin of scent. Joy, her mother's favorite. And then she hung over the sink, humiliated, retching, although there was nothing left in her to heave up. Pen passed her a clean dish towel. When she could breathe normally again, Frankie said,
You're 60 years old. You're almost 61.
Plenty of men my age.
Creeps, sure. Creeps and narcissists. What if your ages were reversed? Would you think that was okay? Would Mom? Surely you remember her, Beatrice, your wife for 30 years. Is she just nothing now?
Of course not. This is not about your mother.
What are you thinking?
Honey, please take a breath, Max said. This is not healthy.
I'll tell the whole world it isn't. Dad, I can't look at you. Don't stand there patting her belly.
I'll leave, but I have to rest for a while. I couldn't sleep all the way back on the plane. I thought one of you was dying.
Frankie, just stay for dinner tonight so we can talk it over. I'm making steamers and corn. Ariel's making her famous olive bread. Lie down for a while and later—
We'll all sit down for dinner like a nice family. What about you, Ariel? This is like if you caught me having sex with your mother.
It's nothing like that.
You're right. It's like you caught me having sex with your grandmother. Your mother's a lot younger than Mac.
Ariel's eyes narrowed then, and she visibly drew back, her long, graceful neck suddenly suggestive of a bird of prey. Frankie saw the face feared even by the mean girls back in high school. Ariel's long-vanished mother, Carlotta, was forbidden territory. Ariel blew her breath out, very slowly. Then she said in a low voice,
That's not how we see it.
That's how everyone else will see it,
Frankie pointed out. Mac's face was reddening now, more stroke than blush. When he looked like that, she could tell he was running out of his famously short supply of patience and about to blow. She was, however, past caring.
Go ahead, Ariel. Picture that.
Frankie, stop it. Penn put in. This is out of control.
You knew I was on the way here,
Frankie said to Ariel.
You weren't supposed to get here until noon or something, Ariel said.
It's 5 in the morning.
Did you want me to see you two going at it?
We were not going at it. We were asleep.
So obviously you never really cared about Beatrice, who you supposedly loved so much. Do you even care about me?
Frankie knew she sounded like a child throwing a tantrum,
fury pushing her past reason. But the question was valid. Was she invisible? Was she inaudible? Did she know her own father at all? Or Ariel? For so many years, her confidant and soulmate? Had she been crazy to think that her father, so eager to showcase his muscled midriff and full head of hair, would cherish her for making him a grandfather? Mac was nowhere near ready to bounce a grandchild on his knee. He wanted to prove that he was still man enough to sire a new line. Carefully, Frankie folded the towel in half and then folded it again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.